Welcome to another edition of the Carolina Bay of the Day, where we study the secondary impacts made by the glacier ice boulders that were ejected by an extraterrestrial impact on the Laurentide ice sheet. Today, I will analyze some deformed bays on the slippery slopes of South Carolina. Near the banks of the Savannah River, there are many Carolina bays that are not elliptical. They were distorted by the viscous flow at the time of their formation by the sloping topography of the terrain. I'm constantly amazed by the colorful beauty of the LiDAR images. On the left side of this image, we see the floodplain of the Savannah River with oxbows and meanders at an elevation of 18 meters above sea level. And 5 kilometers to the east, there is an area covered with Carolina bays. The center of the image has an elevation of 58 meters above sea level, and the bottom of the image corresponds to an elevation of 43 meters above sea level. You will find a link to the LiDAR visualization tool for Google Earth by Michael Davias in the description of the video. There are two things that are immediately obvious. The first one is that the Carolina bays are not elliptical, and second, the emplacement of the bays shows a particular sequence of formation. From the geological law of superposition, it follows that bay number 1 was emplaced first because the creation of bay number 2 overlaid the pointy end of bay number 1. Bay number 3 was created after bay 2 because we can see that it spilled some of its rim into bay number 2. We will now look at bay number 3 in more detail. This is a closer look at these three bays, and we can see that bay number 1 drains into bay number 2, which is at a lower elevation. There's a fringe of alluvial deposits within bay 2 at the point where it intersects bay number 1. Bay number 3, which was created after the first two, has a thickened sandy rim on its southeast side, typical of Carolina bays. A satellite image of the same area shows the bays as different shades of brownish vegetation, but the sandy rim of bay 3 is clearly visible. When studying the physical mechanisms that created the Carolina bays, we have to consider two mechanisms. The first mechanism is the formation of the penetration funnel by the impact of a glacier ice boulder on liquefied ground. The second mechanism is viscous relaxation, which is the flow of material under the force of gravity. Gravity reduces craters and peaks to the ultimate limit of stability, which is a level plain. We expect that the oblique impacts of glacier ice would have created inclined conical cavities, which should be elliptical when viewed from above. For this bay near the Savannah River, we find that the southern half of the bay is elliptical, but the northern half is flattened. We know that the fit of the ellipse is correct because mathematically only 5 points are required to define an ellipse. To understand why the top half of this bay is flattened, it is necessary to notice that the terrain on which these bays are found inclines southward. A cross-section of an impact shows why the upper part of the bay on inclined terrain is flattened during viscous relaxation. Under the force of gravity, all the material flows downhill, but the distortion of the bay is caused because the soil flows faster on the uphill side due to the steeper gradient into the cavity. I tested this idea by making an impact with an ice projectile on a viscous sand and clay target. I then inclined the experimental container during viscous relaxation. As expected, all the material shifted downward, but it flowed into the cavity faster and created the distorted structure. This is probably what happened on the hills of the Savannah River, but on a much larger scale. Needless to say, this process does not require wind for creating the bays. It is not aeolian. For this distorted bays, we need to fit the ellipse to the southern part of the bay in order to estimate the original length of the bay before viscous relaxation. Once we have the estimated length of the bay, we can calculate the size of the ice projectile that made the bay as 1/5 of the major axis of the ellipse. The estimated length is also necessary to calculate the impact angle. Using Google Earth to measure the distance, we find that this bay is 1,230 kilometers from Saginaw Bay, which is the convergence point of the Carolina Bays and the Nebraska Rainwater Basins. Assuming that the launch angle is the same as the impact angle, the ballistic equations indicate that the glacier ice boulder that made this bay was launched at a speed of 3.54 kilometers per second. It had a flight time of 7.23 minutes and reached a height of 231 kilometers above the surface of the Earth. The trajectory was a suborbital space flight in the vacuum of space. Assuming that the launch speed is equal to the impact velocity, an ice projectile with a diameter of 300 meters would have a kinetic energy equivalent to 19.4 megatons of TNT. The Savannah River separates Georgia on the left from South Carolina on the right. These Carolina bays with the flat tops are characterized by Michael Davias as the Bay South archetype template, and they are very common on hilly terrain. I will continue to examine the Carolina Bays one bay at a time. Please subscribe to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays.